real privilege to introduce you to a dear friend, Don Wyrtzen. Some of you know that name, and if you don't, you will. But Don's passion is to communicate truth from Scripture and from music that will touch and transform people's lives. He received an early start, as did his brother David, in ministry, but with music, radio, and television, while associated with his father, Dr. Jack Wyrtzen, who is a founder of Word of Life International. As a graduate of Moody Bible Institute, the King's College, and Dallas Theological Seminary, Don has done work, graduate work in music at the University of North Texas and Vanderbilt with his doctorate from Southwestern Seminary. Dr. Wyrtzen lectures in church music, worship, hymnology in many Christian colleges and seminaries around the country, but his forte, as you will hear, is his virtuoso playing and improvisation. You've probably heard some of the songs he has written: Worthy is the Lamb, Finally Home, Love Was When. He's arranged, orchestrated, and conducted for major artists, including Stephen Curtis Chapman, Michael Card. He's conducted the London Symphony Orchestra and Handel's Messiah, and his own arrangements of Christmas carols. We're privileged to have his wife, Karen, with him. Would you join me in welcoming both of them to our chapel this morning as Don comes?
Well, thank you so much. This morning I want to speak to you about reflecting on music in the American church. By way of introduction, let me tell you that I'm old enough to have known personally four of the five DTS presidents. Dr. Walvoord, who made DTS a powerhouse, was like a father to me. Dr. Campbell used my book on the Psalms in his Sunday school class. Dr. Swindoll hired me to write the theme music for Insight for Living. And Prof. Hendricks told me that Dr. Bailey was a man of uncommon common sense. You know what he said to me? He said that I was highly qualified to be utterly useless. So I'm only encouraged that he told that to a number of other people as well. So even though I was here a long time ago, probably in the Paleolithic era, I'm happy to be here today. Dr. Robinson, Haddon Robinson, taught me to have a major thesis for my sermons and my talks and my lectures. So here's the big idea. If you're going to check out on me, listen to this sentence. I want you to reflect with me on applying biblical principles to music, the arts, and worship. We don't always follow scripture. I mean, do we follow scripture, or do we follow culture, or do we follow marketing research? Do we follow the latest shtick? You can tell I was born in Brooklyn, right? Little Yiddish there. Do we pragmatically follow what brings in the biggest numbers? So the structure for these reflections, which I've never given in this form before, will be built around three parallel concepts. So bear with me, because I'm going to relate these to music and to theology. The first one is dissonance and consonance. The second one will be culture and scripture. And the third one will be form and content. And I think if you'll bear with me, I'll give you some things to work on, to think about, to reflect on. Because I'm not going to do all this for you, but I'm going to try to point you in the right direction. I do have a text, though, for this. And it's Psalm 119, verse 54, which says, "Your decrees are the theme of my song wherever I lodge." Your decrees, the text of Scripture, the law in this case, that's the theme of my song wherever I am. So the psalmist is saying that the word of the Lord has filled him with joy and with singing. So the Lord desires us to be powerful in our lives wherever we are. And that's what I've dedicated my life to. Dedicated my life to trying to help people bridge the gap between music and theology. And we'll talk about that a little bit this morning. There's a lot of resistance and division going on in the church in this area. So I want to start with dissonance and consonance. Two musical terms. And one thing I learned in my sojourn here is how to define my terms. So in case you don't know what dissonance is or consonance, I'm going to define it for you, and then I'm going to show it to you musically, okay? Actually, in music, listening and playing and performing is better than talking. But I'm going to mostly be talking today because I guess I'm a mediocre musician. Dissonance refers to that which is harsh in tone, inharmonious, and strident sounding. Consonance, by way of contrast, refers to that which is harmonious and beautiful. So, in simple language, dissonance sounds ugly, and consonance sounds lovely or beautiful. So let me illustrate it for you musically. This is dissonant. I'll start with intervals. That is two tones simultaneously. Okay, now that's just a major seventh, but it's dissonant, right? Or take an augmented octave. By the way, I don't have this in my notes. Richard Rodgers wrote a song, Bally High, that uses... Ever heard that? That was part of his genius to use a dissonant interval very creatively, actually. An augmented fourth is called a tritone. That's also dissonant. It's the midpoint between the octave, and in the Middle Ages, they called that the devil and music. I'm not kidding. And if you invert it, it's this. And there's a famous piece that starts that way, too, by Saint-Saëns. Dance macabre, it's kind of a Halloween piece, so that's why he started it that way, I guess. So anyway, that's dissonance. Now, consonants would be pretty sounds. I'll stick with intervals here for a minute. A perfect fifth. They use that a lot in country music. If you invert the first one I did, which was a major third, it becomes a minor sixth. Those are all consonant, as against. Got it? Sometimes it's easier to illustrate it than to try to explain it to you with a lot of fancy schmancy English. Let me do it with chords. Let me start with consonant ones. Okay, now blues would be, that's where you flat the third. But these are all consonant. And I love High French School. I love French Impressionism. You could probably hear a little of that. But those are very lovely sounds, like The Rite of Spring by Stravinsky. That's dissonant, you know? But Ravel wrote the Daphnis and Chloe ballet, which uses beautiful, you know, lush French sounds. That's different from. Got it? Okay, now where am I in my notes here? Now, this is my definition of music, and it relates to what I just taught you. One could define music as the interplay of consonants and dissonance as they move through time. Now, I know that's a little convoluted, a little intellectual, but hey, look where we are. One could define music as the interplay of consonants and dissonance as they move through time. So music is in motion. So let me give you an illustration of this. Bach wrote, O Sacred Head Now Wounded, or else he used that hymn in the St. Matthew Passion, and it ends like, and this is a deceptive cadence, so I can repeat the ending again, which really fits in well with praise and worship music, because we repeat a lot in that. Here it is again. Now listen to this. Now that sounds pretty good. Well, it's very good. In fact, it's Bach. It's, trust me, it's magisterial. But listen to what happens if I stop the motion. Is that consonant or dissonant? Dissonant, yeah. But because music moves through time, it's the interplay of consonants with dissonance. So everything I'm going to play before that moment and after would be consonant. So I'll show you again without the repeats. This is all consonant, dissonant. And I don't know why that works. There's a mystery. It's part of the beauty of music. I've never read that in a book, but it's a beautiful illustration about how consonants and dissonants moving through time, you know, harmonize with each other, work with each other. So, dissonance occurs, though, not only in music, but in life as well, and in the way we think about music in the church. There's a lot of dissonance. And even though the worship wars aren't as strident as they used to be, it's still around. I've been working with this for quite a while. I was invited to do lectures for a whole week in a very large, effective church in northern New Jersey. And I not only lectured, but they booked me with people in the church for all my meals, for breakfast, lunch, and supper. And I learned a lot because I would ask them, you know, I asked a man, an older man, why he hated the music at that church. And he said, because they're printing hymns in the bulletin. And I said, why does that bother you? He says, because in my life there's been so much change. And when they started doing something different, it just really threatened me. I thought church was the one place where I could really be secure. But I went out to this beautiful country club with the wife of a very affluent psychiatrist, and she happened to be an opera diva. And so I'm at this restaurant with what Stephen Sondheim calls the ladies who lunch. He wrote a wonderful song about that, with their vodka stingers and all that stuff. And beautiful silver tablecloths, everything. And I'm there with this lady. And I said, so what don't you like about contemporary Christian music? She says, the people, and I won't mention who she was imitating, but she says, they sing with little girl voices. And I said, made the mistake of saying, like what? And she says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto, I can't do it. Can't do falsetto today. So anyway, then I really made a mistake. I said, so how would you have sung it? And I am not kidding you. She belted out a high B flat really loud right in the middle of this country club. And I was in shock. I was under the table laughing my head off. And all the people around us, I mean, we were in the middle of the dining room, they're all laughing. I mean, how often do you hear a diva sing a high B flat in the middle of a country club? So I often think about that when I introduce these questions I'm going to ask you. What do I mean by dissonance in church? I'm going to do it with questions for you. Should we have a choir or a praise team in church? Should we use piano and organ or rhythm instruments? Should we sing hymns or praise songs? Should we have an orchestra or a praise band? Should we use hymn books or big screens? Should we be casual or formal in style and dress? We have an interesting eclectic approach to that right here, right now. Should we favor and target the old or the young? Now, that's just a bunch of questions to just kind of get you thinking about this, because when you get in the pastorate or whatever, maybe where you're working right now in church, people are coming up to you and saying, why do we have to sing those ancient old hymns? How do you answer that kind of stuff? So, in other words, in the first part of my lecture, really, today, I want to show you how you can get consonants out of dissonance in church. And I want to get you started in answering these questions biblically, and I want to point you in the right direction. So I'm not going to preach to you about these verses. I'm not even going to read the text to you. But if you want answers to those questions, I'm going to give them to you right now. So if you want to write down the text And I don't know if that, don't tell me if you're videoing this or whatever, because I probably don't want to know. It'll just make me very nervous. I said to Bill Hendricks yesterday in an email, the last time I was in chapel, his father was here. Dr. Pentecost was here. Mark was here. And I'm thinking the whole time I'm doing this, what am I doing with all these luminaries? It's like my conducting with Toscanini and Leonard Bernstein sitting in the audience. So anyway, I want to give you a biblical text. You can jot them down if you want to. Regarding choirs. And I'm just going to give you one text for each of these. And I want you to follow up on this. You can study this. Regarding choirs, check out Revelation chapter 5. Regarding the organ, and the guitar for that matter, check out Psalm 150, 149 and 150. Regarding hymns, check out Ephesians 5 and Colossians 3, because it talks about psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, and it's in the imperative. I did learn that at DTS. So it's a command. Paul is saying, and he also repeats it in the parallel passage, Colossians 3 and Ephesians 5, both in the imperative. You're commanded to sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. So that would be the answer if somebody says, should I sing praise songs or hymns or whatever? There's your answer. You sing psalms, hymns, and spirit songs. Sorry, I didn't mean to give you an analysis of that one, but I did. Regarding orchestras versus praise bands, check out 1 Chronicles 15, where you learn that Solomon had 4,000 people in his orchestra. So I want you to be biblical here. That's the most important thing that I learned here, is to be biblical. That's my authority, not church authority. Not some celebrity, not some expert, the Bible. Regarding formal versus casual, check out Psalm 96. Regarding old versus young, check out the relationship between Paul and Timothy. We need fathers and we need sons in the church. And Paul builds a lot of his arguments around the family. He talks about older women that you treat more like your mother or maybe your grandma. And so forth. So when you split up the family and church too much, that's not biblical, the way I see it. Now, here's another problem for you. I'll create some more dissonance here. There's a perceived dichotomy between pastors and musicians. Most musicians don't know Bible and theology. Now, they set text to music, but they don't apply the text in terms of principles to their art form. So most musicians don't know the Bible and theology, and that's balanced off by the fact that their bosses, the pastors and theologians, don't know anything about music and the arts. So they don't connect the dots either. Because very few people on the planet really are well-versed and articulate in music and also in theology or Bible. So you just tend to misconnect. You don't connect the dots. So when I was living in Nashville for 19 years, I would often say being a theologian in Nashville is sort of like being a seamstress at a nudist colony. So by that I mean there isn't much call for that kind of work. Now people talk about it. Like, oh, we're so glad you went to DTS and you know your theology because that's going to inform your songs. But that's not what drives the music industry, including both Christian and non-Christian. It's not the Bible and theology for the most part. And trust me, I've worked in this vineyard for a long time now. As I told you, I was in the antediluvian era when I was here. What is it driven by? Bill Gaither told me one time. He came to see me in my office, just the two of us. He's one of the good guys. He's made an incomparable contribution, whether you like his music or not. Anyway, he told me what drives music in Nashville is celebrity and money. And I could add youth, because that's where the money really is, the celebrity and money. And by the way, don't knock the money too much. Don't feel guilty if you get a royalty check. Irving Berlin, the great American songwriter, said, "Son, never hate a song that has sold a million copies." So most music scholars need to hear that, because they, you know, anything beyond the magisterial music of the 18th and 19th century in Germany is not worthy of the glory of God. And I'm going to refute that in a minute, though that is marvelous music. So there's a lot of misconnection going on between pastors and musicians, and between scripture and music, lots of confusion. And the confusion in the church among Christians is mostly about style and about worship for the future. So that's a little bit about consonance and dissonance. Now I want to talk to you about culture and scripture. So let's start with some definitions. Culture refers to custom, civilization, and achievements of a particular time or people. It often refers to the arts and other manifestations of human intellectual achievement. And culture can take various forms. You have a personal culture. You have culture in the church where you are, different cultures. You've got, in our society, high culture or high art, and you've got low art, and you've got pop culture. Scripture, we're talking about culture and scripture. We'll come back to that other stuff in a minute. Scripture refers to our authority. We are commanded to saturate ourselves with it, to apply it, and to obey it. We base what we actually do, however, on culture and on scripture, and we often get them all confused with each other. Now, how did the Apostle Paul handle culture and God's truth? He had the three dominant cultures of the Greco-Roman world in his veins, flowing in his veins. He was a Hebrew of the Hebrews, he was a Jew, he spoke Hellenistic Greek, and he was a Roman citizen. And he used those three cultures to connect with people in the ancient world. He's a beautiful example for you to study. So he used these cultures appropriately in his ministry. And as the need arose, he focused on a particular culture to get his message across, but without compromise. So, sorry to give you the fire hose approach today. I really want to stimulate you to think about this stuff. And don't worry if you understand all of the musical gobbledygook, but think about the scriptural concepts here. Now, you likewise are here to learn to analyze and exegete the text of scripture. You also need to learn how to apply the scripture to the particular culture you serve in, particularly your own church culture. Now I'm going to have to be like Seabiscuit and move quickly here, because I was having too much fun in the beginning. You need to think through issues related to this. Do I join the culture, or do I cross the culture? And part of that may be answered by whatever your gift is. Do I minister to a particular segment of my church culture or to all of God's family? Do I observe key dates in the church year, or do I ignore them and just continue doing expository preaching through the Bible? So that, you know, I may be at Mother's Day, but I'm in Habakkuk. Never learned how to pronounce that properly. So you just go on with wherever you are and forget the church here. I would really encourage you to think about the tone and the culture where you work in church. For example, I've played with orchestras in church, and we'll do the Days of Elijah. Then you'll have a very stirring, passionate sermon where people are going to do serious business with the Lord and get saved or dedicate their lives to the Lord. And instead of doing the Savior is waiting or just as I am, because the days of Elijah, it's on the stand. We're going to do that for the invitation. Jewish directors in Hollywood would never do that. They would never do that on Broadway because the tone is wrong for that moment. So maybe you should use I surrender all. Am I conscious of the tone that is set for specific events in my church? Am I sensitively following the lead of the Holy Spirit as he works surprisingly and unexpectedly? Parenthesis. Was it appropriate for the Hamilton cast to sing America the Beautiful at the Super Bowl? How did Lady Gaga's performance during halftime relate to that particular audience in comparison to what Madonna and Ashley Judd did at the Women's March? Sorry for that digression, Mr. President, but some of you probably saw that. But that's a good example of maybe the right and the wrong way to do this. How do you relate God's powerful word to today's culture with skill and sensitivity in your specific church situation? Where do you go for answers to all of these questions? God's word. And let me just say this. Nobody's paying me to tell you this. What a privilege you have in getting to do this. And Dallas Seminary may be the finest place on the planet for you to learn how to do this. Okay, let's talk really quickly about form and content. Definitions again. And this could really help you as you think about music and the arts and worship. Let me give you some definitions. Form relates to style, to how you are communicating. Content refers to substance, to what you're communicating. Let me repeat that. Form relates to style, to how you are communicating. Actually, I have to be who you are. I told you I was born in Brooklyn. I don't have a Texas accent. I'm of a certain age, I have white hair. All of that relates to my style. And I told you I like high French chord substitutions and impressionism and all that kind of stuff. But content refers to substance, to what you're communicating. Then there's the issue of taste. Now, here's where taste comes in. There should be harmony between the form and the content. Did you get that? Harmony or consonance between the form and the content. In other words, don't try to depict a thunderstorm musically with a piccolo solo. Now, there's nothing morally wrong with piccolo solos. John Philip Sousa wrote an immortal piccolo solo in the Stars and Stripes Forever. But you don't depict a thunderstorm with that. You use timpani and lower brass instruments. Don't attempt to sculpt a gorgeous Texas sunset. It can't be done. You need to paint it. You can't sculpt it. Not because sculpture is wrong or immoral, it's because there's a disjuncture between the form and the content, and it creates dissonance. It creates disharmony. Culture. What is excellent music must be perceived within the context of a particular culture. So some of you are probably thinking about Paul's great words in Philippians 4:8 about excellence. Our goal is to pursue excellence within a particular context, doing the best of which we are capable. Don't let me teach you that, you know, if you're not the greatest in the world, that you're going to take your marbles and go home. You do the best that you can do. Philippians 4:8. God seems to use not only the magisterial music of the 18th and 19th century Germany, like Bach and Mahler and Beethoven, the Nine Symphonies, Mozart, but he also uses folk music indigenous to particular countries, races, and societies. And sometime if I ever come back, I'll talk to you about multicultural, global music, and what I think is the future, where it's all going. Worship and music style in America is not magisterial. In fact, most of the attempts at that are failures. So the music that's playing in the, by the way, go hear the Dallas Symphony because we're losing our conductor to New York Philharmonic. And he's made Dallas Symphony from a wonderful regional orchestra into not only one of the best orchestras in the United States, but one of the greatest orchestras in the world. So if you want to hear a hot orchestra, I know you all have plenty of money to go downtown and hear the Dallas Symphony before Jaap Van Sweden leaves for the Big Apple, where I was born. And trust me, if it costs you $50 for a ticket, that's about a sixth of what it might cost you in New York. So by the time you park your car and everything. So anyway, where am I here? Worship and music style in America is not magisterial. It is pop. It is popular in style. Is this okay? Sure. So I got 2 minutes here to tell you why this is okay. This is the most controversial part. The cosmology of Genesis is similar to the pagan cosmogonies of the biblical world. The Ten Commandments, at some points, are word for word similar to the Code of Hammurabi. David's Psalms are similar in style to Sumerian, Akkadian, and Canaanite songs and hymns. Surprise? Linguists tell us that French is a superior language to English, but if you're going to reach the French, you need to use French, right? They also tell us that classical Greek is more beautiful than Koine Greek. So what did God choose to have the New Testament written in? The common, ordinary tongue. Why? Because that form is sanctified by the inspired word of God, by the content. The content sanctifies the form. Frederick Buechner says, a sacrament is the breaking through of the sacred into the profane. He also says a ritual is the ceremonial acting out of the profane in order to show forth its sacredness. So the Lord seems to be, and you all please correct me if I'm wrong, the Lord seems to be eclectic and uses all sorts of forms in order to reach all kinds of different people and connect with them, with his precious word. So I got to bring this thing in for a landing. So what do we learn from all of this? Probably not a whole lot. Sorry to cover so much stuff so quickly. The answer to all of the dissonance in church is the consonance of skillfully applying God's truth and bringing harmony to the church. Oh, that's a good sentence. Who wrote that? The answer to all of the dissonance in church is the consonance of skillfully applying God's truth and bringing harmony to the church. It uses musical terms to really be an apologia for Bible and theology, which, to my knowledge, is what this school is really still all about, right? Secondly, we must not confuse culture and scripture. We must not confuse our personal preference with spirituality. Further, we must use forms imaginatively to connect with particular audiences. We must be very aware that the Lord sanctifies forms with biblical content. Effective artists and writers have always used popular style and form to connect with people where they are in a particular context. This reflects what you may have been thinking underneath all of this. It reflects the incarnation, where Christ, the living Son of God, humbled himself and became one of us in order to lead us to himself through the glorious gospel and to lead us to maturity. What you do when you're a child and you don't know any better, out of your innocence, you don't do, hopefully, when you're my age. Therefore, wherever we are, going back to Psalm 119:54, that great acrostic psalm, Therefore, wherever we are, his word, his decrees must be the theme of our songs. God's word must be applied very sensitively and carefully to all of the peoples of the world. Can we say amen?
Amen.
Okay, now I always forget this part. Davidson, my dad, was a great evangelist and a great salesman. So, Dad, I'm doing this for you. I go out and play concerts in churches and sometimes get to preach and lecture on stuff like this, maybe more with more biblical text than I gave you today. But I have some brochures with all of my contact information, and I didn't put them on the table. If you want one, you just come see me up here, and I'll give you one. And you can email me, you can make suggestions to me, you can critique me, whatever. Don't do too much critique, I'm really sensitive. My wife can tell you that. And if you don't have time, if you're rushing to a class, Dr. Paul Pettit's gonna love me for this. He has my contact information, okay? Thank you all very much.